Sports Now with Smitty and Shae back here live on blogtalkradio.com. Now being joined by the president and CEO of Resolution Sports, John Archibald. How are you doing tonight, John? All right. First of all, you started Resolution Sports. Tell us a little about it. How long ago did you start, and what exactly do you guys do?
The company itself was actually founded in 2008, so right now it's amid its fourth year of operation, and it was a journey to get to the point where it was that we could also speak about if you guys felt like hearing the history on that. But the company itself is set up with two branches. The first branch is as a sports communication firm, kind of dealing with everything within the realm of communication, whether that be press releases, social media, some design work, anything that kind of falls into that territory. And then the second branch of it, which I later developed after starting the company, was I was kind of looking at a way to better market what I was doing, and I needed more content on my site, being a writer, and things like that. So I kind of decided, well, why not create a second branch to it where I serve as a sports media source? It kind of went out and started to cover events and writing feature things for a website and everything. So now if you look at it, it's almost like there's two departments to it. One is a sports communication firm where I have a group of partners that I deal with. I know other people call them clients. I hate that word, with a passion, because I feel if I'm working with somebody, they're a partner. But, that's kind of how it's set up, though, with the two branches.
Hey, talk about that a little bit, John. I think that's really interesting. You say you don't like that word client, and I think that's really important. How important do you feel that is to really develop relationships with your partner?
Well, the way I look at it is, some of the client, if you think about the word client, and if you're a company, to me it kind of reminds me of a situation like a boss and an employee. It's somebody feels like they're, bigger than the other, and to me, my company fails. It does not succeed unless I have people that I'm working with that are partners. And each of these groups that, entrust things upon me to help their company succeed is going to make my company succeed. To me, we're on even territory. That's a partner. That's somebody that's helping build me. And I know for a fact, without the people that I've been working with, there's no way I'm still going today, and there's no way I'm going to keep going where I'm going. So, to me, if I look at people as clients and try to think that I'm better than anybody that's helping me build what I'm building, I've already failed. So, to me, it's a partner. If you go to my website, you'll see on my site, partners is there. You'll never see the word client.
Hey, was this something that you've always wanted to do, or you kind of fell into a situation and kind of just went with it?
Well, kind of the background of what happened was I actually grew up in Tennessee, went to the University of Tennessee at Chattanooga, go Mocs, and started off, sports was always my passion. Growing up, I tried to see how many sports I could play in a calendar year, whether it's different multiple leagues, however it's dealt out. I tried to play as many sports as I could, and it kind of got to the point when I got into college. God blessed me with a lot of things, but unfortunately, being a professional athlete wasn't one of the things that I was going to be able to do. So I had to find my way into the world of sports, another way. And what happened there is I interned in the sports information department in my schools where I kind of got my start, and got my degree in communication. I kind of loved the world of communication. Sports was the passion, put them both together. From there, I actually took off to Florida and worked with the Arena Football Team called the Florida Firecats right out of college, and kind of had to deal with a lot when we were down there. That was when Hurricane Charlie hit. Unfortunately, we had to deal with one of our players actually died in a car accident while we were down there. And we ended up winning the championship. So, there was a lot of things that dealt with right off the bat with that a lot of people don't go through in a sports career, let alone their first season. So it kind of built something from there. From there, I actually headed up to New Jersey, where my family is from and where I now live. And they were kind of back in this area because I figured the best way for me to make something work in sports is go to the hub of where sports are, and they're all over the place up here. Basically started calling every team from the minor league level, the professional level, indoor soccer, lacrosse, football, didn't matter what it was, just kind of got in wherever I could get in and got to the point where I landed a job with a professional indoor soccer team called the New Jersey Ironmen in Newark, New Jersey, that were owned by the New Jersey Devils. And I started having people ask me on the side if I could do things for them, so I'd pick up side work. And I had about an hour train ride back and forth every day. One day I was sitting there and I was like, technically the one thing you need to own your own business is to actually have people to do business for, which I technically had. And I kid you not, the whole reason Resolution Sports was originally founded was I said in my head, it'd be cool just to be able to tell people I own my own business. So I actually went, filed the paperwork. You know, from there, unfortunately, the Ironman's closed up shop, and I just went full force ahead, turning over every stone again like I was before, and started to pick up, you know, a partner base, and it's kind of built to where it is now, and it really kind of baffles me, you know, with the point it's gotten to be honest with you.
Hey, John, I'm reading your bio here on your website, and it says you were the general manager of the New Jersey Terminators. Talk about that experience
name,
a little
right?
bit. I love that name. And how did that shape how you do your business, being on that other side as a general manager?
You know, I'll tell you what. The New Jersey Terminators played in a league called the North American Football League, which is – it was basically, it's a minor league football league, an outdoor league, you know, not anywhere to the level of like United Football League. It's basically was everybody had a full-time job, and it's a lot of the semi-pro stuff that you see. And what was great about that is working with teams like that, it's really going to keep you humble. It's really going to, you know, keep things level-headed. And a lot of those players and you know, the people I worked with them before are still people that I'm good friends with now that help pave some certain ways. But it was good because a general manager at that level is kind of hands-on to everything that's going on, but we're not talking about the NFL. You know, it's not to the extent of all those kind of things, but it gives you the ability to kind of get your hands in everything, if that makes any sense.
And John, you said you studied, you got your bachelor's in communication, and you had a passion for sports. A lot of people, including one of the guys I like a lot, Mark Cuban, the owner of the Dallas Mavericks, has said, if you're thinking about studying sports management, don't do it. He just said it, and you own a business, and you know very well, and you probably agree with him, saying that he'd rather hire someone that has various talents, such as business or accounting, rather than someone with sports management degree. What's your take on the whole sports management degree?
You know, I guess first I'll say is I don't want to discourage anyone from doing sports management. But what I will say for someone like me that took the path of going through communication, it's a lot of the law and ethics. It's a lot of these major cases. It's a lot of really learning how to write and, you know, do all these other things. And luckily, Chattanooga has a really good communication program. And what it did best is it diversified me. You know, it didn't make me strictly sports. I already knew the path I wanted to go. But it's almost like if you put the blinders on, you're not going to make yourself very versatile. You know, you're not going to be very renaissance. You're not going to have experience in a lot of different things. And that's one of the things that's also been great with working in a lot of different sports is I don't have just one set path of how this sport operates or how that sport operates. I can see how all these sports, kind of how they handle things, you pluck and pull the things that are successful with the various organizations, and you can apply them to one. And that versatility of yourself, you know, makes you a lot more valuable as well, and, you know, it makes it a lot more fun, too. So it's good to be versatile, but I don't want to discourage people from going to sports management, but don't be afraid to give other degrees a look.
Now, John, before we came on air tonight, you were telling us that you're a lifelong Detroit Tigers fan. When you were going through all your history there, you didn't say anything about Michigan. How did you become associated with a team up in Michigan?
Yeah, well, it's funny. Well, I'll take you back into the brain of me at 6 years old. I actually started collecting baseball cards, and I already had OCD at six and had all my cards categorized by teams. And I remember on that year's Topps cards, they had the symbols on the card. And my brother said to me, he goes, "You can't collect baseball cards if you don't have a favorite team." And I was like, "All right, give me a minute." So I flipped through all my cards, and I said, "The Detroit Tigers." And he said, "Why?" I said, "They have the coolest symbol." And he's like, "Okay." They're thinking of a six-year-old, right? And he's like, "All right, well, you can't have a favorite team if you don't have a favorite player." I said, "All right." Went through all my Tigers cards, and I said, "Lance Parrish, he is the coolest name." That's literally how it started. And I never faltered. You know, growing up in Tennessee, when everybody was a Braves fan during that unbelievable run that they had, you know, and, you know, what we dealt with before, you know, we've turned the tide now and are doing well, you know, with the almost having the worst record in pro sports history, all those things. I dealt with it all, got through it all, always stuck by the team. And, you know, I'll let you guys know now that, you know, down here anywhere in New Jersey, when people try to go around wearing a Tiger hat like it's cool now, I'm not afraid to rip it off their head.
Hey, John, give us your thoughts of what the Tigers have done this year. As a lifelong fan, what do you think of the move to bring in Prince Fielder, and what are your thoughts of the team so far this season?
I'll tell you what, I loved Cecil Fielder. You know, it's unfortunate kind of how, Cecil and Prince don't get along, but it's almost like a piece of the family was brought back when Prince came in. And I'll tell you what, you tell me anybody that can sit and watch that lineup, and when you're going to go through Miguel Cabrera and Prince Fielder back-to-back, and that's not fun to watch. I mean, it's fun for everybody except those nine guys on the other side of the field. And it's I love the moves they made. And the thing that I really love most about this year's Tigers is when you watch them, they're having so much fun. You know, they truly enjoy being around each other, you know, from the pitching staff, you know, to Leland in the dugout. We've got one of the last old school managers in baseball, you know, that still wears the spikes in the dugout. You know, I just love all the things going on with the Tigers right now. And it's so much fun to watch every time, you know, Verlander pitches, you know, and Papa Grande gets us all nervous, but, you know, fortunately he doesn't pull the same moves Todd Jones used to do to us, so I'm good with that situation. But they're just so much fun to watch, and you can really tell they're having fun playing the game, so that makes it that much more enjoyable.
Now, you've got to experience a lot. You got to do a lot throughout the sports world. What would be your one greatest sports memory, whether it be something you were directly related with, something you played, or something you just witnessed? What would be your greatest sports memory so far in your young life?
I'll tell you what, that's actually a tough question. That as a fan, you know, we'd open up a whole nother conversation if I tried to explain how this duo happened. But I'm a diehard Eagles fan as well, so I'm still waiting on a championship between, you know, those two teams. So I can't say either in those. Used to follow Barkley wherever he went when I was a kid, so I'm still heartbroken and can't stand the Bulls because of, John Paxson hitting that three. So probably would have to go into the professional life. And kind of some of the things that I've done is it's been a hard road. You know, I've literally relocated my life twice pursuing this, and I've really – when you constantly reach out to all these different teams and you're constantly going into a new environment of people that you've never met before, so it's a lot of, you know – unusual situations where you got to really kind of, be able to get yourself comfortable fast. So what I've tried to do throughout time is when those moments hit where you're in something really, really special, I literally can take my head, I scan and take mental images so I never forget, because when those times get hard, I can always reflect back to them. Some of those moments I'd say were, without question, winning the championship down in Florida after everything we went through. The guy that was the fullback on our team actually ran for 500 yards that year, which would be like an NFL running back running for 3,000. A guy by the name of Steve Gorey. I can remember after that game, we'd gotten really close that year. You know, when I saw him after the game just winning a championship, like that was a really cool moment. Another really cool moment is I spent a couple years working with the Rutgers football program, and luckily I picked the two Ray Rice years that I was there. And I can remember the Louisville game being down in the end zone. You know, when it's literally, this is a team that played the first college football game. It had never in the history of this program been in a situation as big as they were against Louisville when they beat them on that Thursday night when Louisville was ranked second. And, you know, when you look around these alumni that have kind of just been beat up all the time and all this mess, and, you know, you take a look around, and it's literally a moment that has never happened to this program before. That was definitely cool. Another thing that was really cool was the first game with the Ironmen. I don't know if I'd mentioned you guys before, but growing up, Tony Meola was always my favorite soccer player, no question. It wasn't a goalkeeper thing because I played fullback. I just always loved Tony Meola. And when I worked with the Ironmen, I remember when I went in for the interview and everything, and they were like, yeah, we're talking to Tony Meola about coming out and doing some stuff with us. I was like, oh, cool. From a marketing perspective, they're like, no, we're bringing him into play. Blew my mind. You know, now all of a sudden a guy that's my lifelong favorite player is now someone that I'm working with, setting up interviews for, and this guy could not be any more professional. He could have easily said to me, you know, I've got 100 caps with the national team, I've won an MVP in MLS. You know, who are you? Never was like that for a second. The guy cannot be any more professional, to the point now where we're very good friends, and actually GK1 Sports, his company, is now one of my company partners, and he's one of the people that got Resolution Sports off the ground. So that whole thing is something I'm very proud of and happy about. And I've since become very involved in the world of boxing. And Derek Webster, you guys had on last week, I would say kind of the whole relationship that's kind of built with him, and then his one of his mitt guys, a guy by Rick Coward, who's a world-renowned a mitt guy and everything, and kind of the relationship we're brewing there amongst us as a team. And it's kind of like these collective things, you know, are a lot of, you know, bringing together. So with your quick, easy question, I just rambled on for 15 minutes. I guess it's more like building up relationships that I'd say are probably the most memorable.
Now, you kind of opened the door for my next. You kind of opened the door for my next question, John. Talking about Tony Mueller, you hit the head right, or the nail right on the head there. When we talked to him, he was absolute class act. Has soccer always been something that you've been associated with growing up and playing so many sports?
Soccer is a sport I played all the way up through in high school. For our high school, I played football and soccer because they were down south. You know, the South operates on football in the fall, so soccer happens in the spring. And but going into high school, going back to what I was talking about, like trying to play as many things as I could, I actually played baseball in the summer when we had our summer workouts for football. Had football in the fall and found a AYSO soccer team I could play for on Sundays that didn't practice. Then that winter we had an independent basketball league, you know, so constantly had things in rotation. Where you saw, kind of played a little bit of everything. The sports I probably played the longest were, you know, soccer and baseball all the way through, but I finished out, you know, with football and soccer, you know, in high school. And then when I got into college, I kind of dabbled in boxing a little bit, but, you know, never really went anywhere with that, you know, as far as competing.
Hey, John, finally, you said you're kind of relatively new, 2008, you know, only been around for 4 years. What are your goals for this company as you move forward?
I'll tell you, you know, like I said at first, I wasn't even sure what the goals are and what I was trying to do. I think, you know, you people say you find your passion and, you know, you build it from there, and that's how you make things work. And so at first, I don't think I really had any goals, you know, but the thing is, with a company like this, there really isn't one that exists as far as what it is I've kind of built. So what's nice is there's no blueprints. You're able to make it yourself. And so kind of the goals change as you go. But I think probably here for the immediate future, you know, what's great is like when you kind of start talking about, you know, having partners and things like that. Like with Derek Webster, who I mentioned, it's almost like our goals now are for Team Webster. You know, how far can Derek get this year? You know, how close can we start getting him to winning that world title? Those things are goals. You know, as a company, it's just a matter of keeping that foundation strong and continue to surround myself with good people and grow. You know, kind of from that perspective, it's a matter of just keep making it more stable, make the foundation firmer, and really just be able to set it up for the long haul where it's going to last, you know, a very long time.
I told Derek last week when he was on the show that if he wants to get more fans and stuff, and he wants people to come out to his fights, he ought to have them last more than 33 seconds.
Yeah, you know what I mean? This guy, I tell you what, you can actually go there's actually a video that Derek and I did together the day of that fight. You know, Derek and I kind of take an approach with a lot of videos that we do. It's almost like our own 24/7 type of thing. Is, you know, we've done a whole series of videos. But we did a video that night that, no joke, I kind of wanted to take people into the locker room of a fight or the day of a fight. You know, what's really going on in their head? What's really happening the day of a fight? So our video starts with cool, calm Derek, you know, just in the back in the locker room, just kind of hanging out, talking. Moves on to where the fights are getting started. You know, he gets taped up. You know, he's shadow boxing in the locker room. You know, it's starting to get a little bit more intense. To the point where I recorded the entire intro of Derek coming in. I recorded the entire introductions of both fighters being introduced. I recorded Derek's entire 40-second fight, recorded his entire celebration, and did a post-interview, and I think the whole video is like 12 minutes long. Like, it was going into that fight, there was just no way that guy was getting out of the first round. And it was just Derek just had it in his head. He was getting him out of there as fast as possible. And I knew that this would be the perfect time to shoot, like, this total video, because the fight part was not going to last very long.
All right, John, go ahead and sell your company for us. Where can we find out more information, websites, Facebook, Twitter? What's some of that good stuff for us?
I love coming on this show. website is www.ressports.com, R-E-S-sports.com. And kind of going back to Tony with that is resolutionsports.com. Nobody ever put a site up for it, but it was gone. And so speaking with Tony Miola, he was like, why not call it the Res? It's catchy. So that's where I came up with Res Sports, and or actually Tony came up with it. And but now it's so easy for everybody to say, you know, go to the Res, follow this at the Res. And with shortened handles like with Twitter and everything, it makes it a lot easier. So www.ressports.com. Twitter is at Res Sports. Facebook.com/ResSports. Also on Google Plus, YouTube is, I bet you could guess, youtube.com/ResSports. But the website can direct you everywhere from there, and, you know, ResSports.com. But you follow me on Twitter, I usually ramble a lot of things and, you know, lose followers and gain them back because I'll, you know, go on tangents about things. But isn't that what Twitter's for?
I completely agree with you, John. Hey, thanks for joining us. And anytime you want to be on, we'll definitely have you on in the future if you feel like coming back and joining us.
Oh, absolutely. Anytime you guys want me on, you just say the word, I'm there for you. And I just want to tell you guys, I appreciate, you know, not only having me on, but, you know, with some of the other people that you brought on the show and everything that are, you know, people that I deal with. I think you guys have put on a great show. I listen to you, you know, literally do it, try to listen to you each night and check you guys out. You put on a good show. It's an entertaining show. And, you know, definitely want to encourage you guys to keep doing what you're doing because you're doing a very good job with it.
Well, we definitely appreciate it, John. And like I said, we look forward to talking to you in the future. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Absolutely. You guys have a good night. Go Tigers.
All right, you too, John. Go Tigers.
Go Tigers.
All right, see you guys.
John Archibald, the president and CEO of Resolution Sports, joining us here on Sports. Now let's take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
The Huron Daily Tribune, Huron County's daily published newspaper, reporting to you the latest breaking local news 5 days a week with one of the best coverage of